minions of capital. What do you want?
Pick up the gun lying in the sand. His gaze follows your motions. The rifle feels surprisingly light in your hand, frame stocked and patched in places with tape and wire. The rifle's in a shabby state, like a crutch that's been seen too much travel. Hieroglyphs are embossed into the forearm made of walnut. On the butt, you see Vespertine writing, burnt into the wood. Triangong 4.46mm, made in Xin Yao. This uses jacketed ammunition, 4.46. The right type and the right caliber, the lieutenant nods, glancing at the gun. All right, task complete. Empathy says he's liking this. It's as he said, it's a Triangong, made in Xin Yao. No one said it has to be a Bell McGrave. The lieutenant does not take his eyes off the old man. We were just guessing. Visual calculus says, from ballistics, it could have easily been a Triangong, too. Doesn't matter if it was made in shanty. All it has to do is use jacketed ammunition, and it does. The old man keeps following your emotions with his gaze. His left arm twitches suddenly. I can't access that menu. This looked very much like the murder weapon, Rhetoric says. It can be used against him later. I ain't going anywhere. Okay, I want to look at this. R$70. The bolt-action 4.46 caliber Triangong is the poor man's sniper rifle. While not the most reliable of firearms, it is relatively precise due to a very manageable recoil, thus allowing the shooter to take multiple consecutive shots first. This particular piece is missing a scope, though. Where's the scope? Is eyesight that good that it doesn't need a scope? There's one more save, because I think we could save during conversations, but I prefer not to do that.
Minions of Capital, what do you want?
One more time, Mr. Dross, the Colonel. We need to talk about you killing him. Petty bourgeois law. He snorts and spits. This is all you care about, right? The only thing in the world for you types. Perception says, a drop of blood in the saliva. Logic says, that's right. Pile it all on him now. Three should do it. Maybe four. Maybells, behind the victim's window. I saw them growing here. Damn Maybells. He looks at the blossoming field. The whole island is turning white with them. What were they like, stuck to him and they fell off or something? He seems tender suddenly, nostalgic even. A strange mood swing, Empathy says. So many this year, too. The spring is coming. No, it's already here. Wash the filth away. I haven't seen these flowers anywhere else in Martinez. Only here. They blossom on the islets before. We fertilize them with our blood. He looks for the water. Resurrection was snow white in May, before they ruined it. The coast, too, before they piled their containers on top of it, filled with broken, useless trash for fat-fingered bourgeois children to play with. You must get around a lot to stay undetected all these years. The lieutenant's voice is soft, friendly. Do you know any secret paths? Pinball workshops? I may. A curious tremor passes his face. A young woman named Classier. Ring any bells? Flowers like these were behind her window. Classier. You know her, right? She had intimate relations with the victim, the mercenary. With the victim. He turns his sight from the whitening field of flowers and falls silent. Then the muscles in his jaw twitch, a spasm. Composure says, there is a small tremble, looks like a smile, a crooked smile, yet isn't quite voluntary. He's about to burst. I wonder what brand of boots you're wearing. Everything is brands with you individualists. Who cares what brand my shoes are? Sansa. He looks at his running shoes, covered in mud. Some crap. Show me the soles, please, Mr. Dross, Kim says. Imbecile. The old man stretches out his leg. A black and white spiral pattern covers the sole of the worn-out old running shoes on his feet. Perception says, the maker is called Sanserik. You see their V-shaped logo, but can't make out the size. Visual calculus says, these are not the unusual horizontal pattern soles you saw in the dust on the floor of the hidden room. They do, however, seem to be about the same size. The size fits, but not the sole. The lieutenant comes to the same conclusion. Drama. Wait, maybe it's simpler than that. Drama says, sire, he doesn't have to be wearing them right now. People change shoes. It doesn't mean you weren't there, near the room the victim died in, sneaking around. Racking those brains, are you? He squints at you, black pearls gleaming with hatred, desperate to report something back to your masters. They must have really loved that dead... Beep. The lieutenant gives you a quick sideways glance and nods to acknowledge. Drama says the prints were his, you can see it in those eyes, but he can't keep them from flickering, looking for something. The old man stares at his own prints in the ash around the fire, silent suddenly, with some strange process within him, a gush of wind, seagulls in the distance. You almost got him, logic says, just a last little push. I don't need your cooperation. I've got this. Heh. Not a lot of guns around that use military-grade ammunition, are there? Kim asks. It's a real gun, he points to your sidearm. Not like your little musketeer pistol. I've seen you prance around with that, jumping hoops for the liberals. You look like imbeciles. Why don't you ask them to give you real weapons? He chortles. Going against automatic rifles with these toy guns? Of course you got those boys killed. Half-Life said, damn, he saw you. He's watched it happen. Visual calculus says, he would have a good view of the tribunal from here. It's not just empty boasting. And Volition says, so he saw you. Okay, so what? Don't let it divert you. Stop changing the subject. We have the murder weapon. You know what? The lieutenant looks at the weapon demonstratively. You're right. I'm convinced this made the shot. Should we call it? Dramatically ask, you think we have the murder weapon? 4.46 jacketed ammunition, modified for range, he lists. We have it. This is it. I'm calling it. We have the murder weapon. Good. The lieutenant takes out his notebook and draws a single line. And I leveled up again. Still need to extract the confession. The only thing we didn't take was to become a racist with the racist thought. Three skill points. Well, I'm gonna save them. I don't know what else to use them on right now. This feels good, doesn't it? Tying things up like this. When you have the murder weapon, you have the killer. Murder. The old man does not say more. He just glances into the reeds and then twitches once more. He suddenly jerks to life. You know who he was? A coalition-trained murderer, armored and armed. He wasn't human. The blunt end of a hammer, dripping with blood. He was a killer, but he was still under the protection of the law. Beating us to the ground, moaning with joy, he breathes in with strange animation. You hounds get so thorough when a company-trained killer dies. I haven't seen you on this coast for 40 years, you know. Maybe I should have killed one sooner. Got your attention. He looks you dead in the eye, pupils shaking. Now you stop beating druggies and prostitutes in your basement. Now you come to investigate. Not when they die by the hundreds. He breathes through flared nostrils. Redrick says, this is it. Shot him. Shot him. Say shot him and not killed him. So you shot him. Oh, the inhumanity. He closes his black eyes. One paramilitary less in Revachol. You can almost see him squeeze a tear out of his eye. His fists begin to tremble from the anger. The lieutenant raises his right arm to hush you. A speed of course says, hush. He does not need to be pushed anymore. The ball is rolling. while the lieutenant listens, holding his breath. Alright. Kim and Esprit de Corps telling me to hush. Let's hold our breath. I had them in my sights, both of them. Him and the whore. I was breathing with them, in phase, and I pulled the trigger and flew on the air until it landed in his mouth. He begins to smile. I didn't think I had a shot like that at me anymore. I did. I saw him kneel there with his mouth full of death and that stupid look on his face. The smile quivers, and his member still in her. Then what? Nothing. I went to sleep. Next morning there were Maybells everywhere. The world was white. What's left of it anyway. My last spring here, I knew the fascists would come to avenge their own. And so they did. The lieutenant just looks at him for one, maybe 2 seconds, then breaks the silence. Mr. Dross, are you aware you're confessing the murder? Test complete. Yes. A single word is all he gives. I got 4 skill points. And no things to do except that one thing. Wow. The lieutenant takes out his notebook slowly, very slowly, and you are looking at them. The victim and a young woman having sex through the scope of your rifle that night before you shot him? Where is the scope? Because there's no scope on that gun. The old man nods. Why? Because that's what they were doing. He shrugs, then smacks his lips. Logic says, the motive. This is where the motive is going to come from. I don't understand. He turns to you. Do you, detective? I don't understand this part. Why were you looking at them that night? I'm always looking. He cocks his head to the side, then turns his eyes to the city. Another tremor passes his left side, lower in intensity. I got another thing. Extract a motive. Why did he do this thing? Why? Are you always looking through the scope of a rifle? He explains. I'm just trying to understand. A rifle scope has the best magnification. And if you don't like it... Click! You pull the trigger. Yes. He looks you in the eye. Think of it as a form of critique. Conceptualization says he will not stop now. These dialectical materialist types never do. Exploit it. Logic says, you got him going. Connect every little piece now. Wrap this up like a gift. I'm thinking maybe I can do some of these things and get this higher. What specifically did you not like about what you saw the night of the murder? Them screwing. He looks at the charred wood. I didn't like that. So you were jealous? Jealousy is a reactionary concept. I didn't like the Reaver enjoying himself. Drugged out, soothed in the arms of a young woman. I wanted him to die so he could not enjoy life anymore. And I wanted her to see his head explode. He nods. That too. She should know better than to hold a child murderer between her thighs. I knew he'd be there for one more second, writhing. That's all it takes for the bullet to reach his head, he squints. Now that I think of it, I wasn't aiming for his mouth. I wanted his brains to spill out on her. But, he shrugs. You can't have everything. Boy. I feel so bad for you. How long had you been watching her? Since she came to Martinez. I saw her sneaking in the reeds early in the morning, behind the Feld building. It was dark, still winter. She didn't have her skimpy outfit on then. Just a spot in the night. Moving. Oh, is that when she left her fake ID? Maybe he took it then. Past the Feld building, on the coast? What was she doing there? She put her fake ID into a buoy. Hiding something in the water. She had a fag after she'd done it. A cigarette. Just for some people who may not know what that means in European countries. I was up in the ruins there. She couldn't see me, but I could see her, smoking. She was nervous, but not scared. What do you think she hid there? Her passport, and tickets to Valer's, he coughs, and from there to Kasherbrum. Encyclopedia says, in the free state of Seminine, hidden away at the edge of the earth near the pale. This is the hidden buoy she told us about. You looked into it? He nods, after she was gone. Did you keep what was in it? Kim asked. When we found the submersible, it was empty. No. Why would I do that? I didn't need tickets to Villiers. If I put them back, if I wanted to extort someone, I'd do better. Villiers here. Villiers here. Rhetoric says, this implies that he's thought about extorting her. Logic says, also a little inconsistency here. He was surprised to hear her name Classier before. Would he not have seen it on the documents? Isn't her name something else on the documents, rather? She had, like, two fake names. Are you sure? We checked the submersible. There was nothing there. Looks to the reeds, confused. Why would I need that trash? I'm not going to Villiers. Composure says, a strange confusion comes over him from time to time. Some kind of aberration of the nervous system? You saw her name on the passport, but before when I said her name was Classier, you didn't seem to recognize it. It didn't say Classier in there. He shakes his head. Yeah, we know that. It was something else. I forget the name. What did it say her name was in the passport? It was something... He stutters. I don't remember. It was dark that morning. I only remember her face on the photo. Yeah, I don't remember either. So don't feel bad, deserter. Moving on, did you continue watching her after this? I did. He almost smiles. She had a face like an archipelago with those birthmarks, and a body, hard and lean and bruised all over, black and yellow. I could see she's taken a beating. I could see who she was, too. He nods. A spook. On the run. Revachol's the cloaca of capital now. All the bagmen and arms dealers end up here to do drugs and have sex like animals. Kim says you could tell she was a spook from the documents? She had different color hair on the photo, and glasses. Forged. Some sordid bourgeois affair. I've heard about this kind of thing on the radio. Drama says he's setting it up for you. Visual calculus says the bruises, you can't make that out in the scope. And you could see her bruises through the scope of a rifle? You can't see bruises through a scope. It's just a blur. He shakes his silvery gray beard. We'll come to this after. Now do it. Reaction speed. +1 for footprints in the dust and found the peephole. +2 for could have changed shoes. How does he know about those minute details about her body? It quickly comes to you. Reaction speed says. The bruises on her body. Any chance you've seen them through a hole in the wall? Oh yes, he smacks his lips. Cutting those drugs of hers into little lines with a knife, masturbating. Kim asked, did you make that hole? With a clip point knife. Ever see her through a window? On a roof? Like that, too, yes, he nods, bending like a bow against the glass. You've been through the secret route behind the whirling and rags. Those are your footprints there. You just changed your shoes. I've been through all of Martinez, every nook and cranny. And that, too. Yes, that, too. He shakes his head, almost in awe. The things they did in that little room. What she'd do to feel good. He explains. Funny, the way light works. You turn it on inside, and it gets so dark out, you can't see a man looking in. I learned that in the '20s when they were still hunting me. I've seen people do stuff, but... He keeps shaking his head. Rhetoric says, those two took the cake. You hear the familiar scribble of the lieutenant's pen. A quick glance at you. Yield morale. One more loose end down, Esprit de Corps says. We're doing this, detective. Then at the man, Kim asked, how did you get in there? The hidden pinball workshop. I can just walk in there now, after a good wash. I told you, they think I'm an antisocial. Closing hour's a good time. The kitchen's empty. You had to open the steel door in the kitchen, Kim asked. How? I got that open a long time ago. Some bourgeois game merchant lived there. I don't know. 15 years ago? He left spare keys all over, and I took one. that I saw her turn the light on one night in my scope. He points toward the whirling in rags. Interfacing says, and he found use for it, a spare key, like the one hanging behind the Union Box window. Did you have feelings for that woman? There's nothing to hold on to. Only this. It's not enough. Perception says, the coals of his eyes glisten suddenly, like stones dripping with water. Is he crying? Man needs to feel something else. In this fight, it helps if you have your eye on something there. Looks to the city. It's weakness. I know. Was that why you left the dried flowers behind our window? No. He starts to shake his head again, a sunflower on a withered stalk. Why then? I don't really know. I was there one night and she was crying like a child, in the corner of her room, on the floor, like she does sometimes. When was this? The day after I'd killed him. And you brought her Maybells? Yes. He looks at the charred logs. I don't know why I do the things I do anymore. You wanted to console her? Maybe. He lowers his head and just stares at the logs. I told you, I have holes in my brain now. I wouldn't just sit here waiting for you. If you came 10 years ago, I would have killed you. He wipes his eye. In the silence, the lieutenant draws a line in his notes, then nods at you once more. A speed of course says, one more down. So in conclusion, it wasn't about him, it was about her. Yeah, her, he repeats, staring at the ashes, then the reeds. There's a twitch in the corner of his eye. Task complete for extracting a motive and level up again. And we have nothing again. And I have 5 skill points, so I don't know what to use them for. The lieutenant nods at you in acknowledgement. That's it. Motive. We have it, Espeeda Kor says. The old man looks at you, suddenly remembering something. Where is she, that Clashier? I haven't seen her there for days. Did she lead us here? She got away. Yeah, I guess their letter said that. She got away, but she led us here first. She figured out someone was watching her from the sea fort. Gone. He looks to the city and nods. I knew it. She kept staring into the scope this last week, at the island, like she knew. She'd look, at night, crying or smoking on the roof, staring right in me. He adds, to no one in particular. It doesn't matter. Rhetoric says, he knew she knows. She was looking at the island, figuring it out, day by day, cigarette by cigarette. We could get more. The lieutenant uses the opportunity to tell you, in a lowered voice, we've got him talking. Logic says, who knows what he's seen and done over the years? Physical instrument says, enough. Take him in, bend his arms behind his back, and end this. Still low for this. Been looking at anything else you haven't liked? A tragic comedy. He shakes to life. Druggies, prostitutes, and renters? Rentieres? Composure says a strange little engine seems to fire up in him again. It straightens his back. Conceptualization says the familiar putt-putt-putt of hatred. More specifically? Specifically, the whole city is a charnel house, stripped clean and draped in neon. But Martinez, he shakes his head in grave disgust. Martinez is the worst. How come? Because of the racists. Everyone is a racist in Martinez. It's their favorite thing to do in the whole world. Listening to race-themed radio shows. In the ruins. In their lorries. He points inland. Pump full of steroids and Radio Revachol 92. Race this, race that. It's all sanctioned by that Social Democratic Union and the farce of a social democrat who runs it. Mr. Clare? Yes, the fly larva in his container. He let some nihilistic advertising yuppies erect a statue of Felipe III, a syphilitic murderer, on the town square, to spit on the working class. Let him finish. Not since the serfs of ancient Paracarnassus has history produced a more inert social class than the Martinez proletariat. The rest of Revachol at least pretends to rebuild. These people still live in ruins. In tents, like animals. He points to the church. like those boom-boom morons on the ice. A pity they didn't drown in that tent of theirs. He keeps shaking his head with sorrow for the sight he missed. Is that all? Or is he still talking about the fishing village? The worst of them is the blood-drenched Sucriant on her yacht, licking her lips. The old whore is gone now. Her gun-toting porcelain men are dead. So actually, no. The worst is that old bleep parading around in his uniform, throwing balls all day. It's not enough that the racists and liberals are dancing our graves. The old loyalist ghouls still parade the ruins, too. Talking about Renee. Renee's dead. Every morning he's there, while the parasites he fought to protect off are in Ozone, or Croyant Moraine, or some other island they've built their palaces on, feeding on drugs and having sex with their own children. Say nothing. That's all the rich really want. Sex with their own children. Throughout history, even the royal bloodline of the suzerain, it's all just an excuse for them to have sordid sex. At least that old bleep Frizzell is now dead. Oh, Renee. Just nod. We did good when we pushed him under that horse car. If only, in the 30s, those disco whores. What follows is ominous mumbling. You cannot make out a single word. Half-Light says, the disco whores are too much. Hatred shuts down his brain's language center, leaving only a nonsensical sputter. Conceptualization says, there was something about a statue and nihilistic advertising agency people might be worth investigating. There was something about the statue on the roundabout, and syphilis? Syphilis is a disease Felipe II contracted in a whorehouse. He fires quickly. The statue is an abomination. An abomination? The bacteria entered his brain and made him squander trillions on sparkling wine, cocainum, and monuments of himself. His son, Philippe III, the insane, contracted syphilis in the womb. He breathes in with a wheeze of hatred. Encyclopedia says, that is technically possible, though Philippe III was not actually syphilitic, he was just mad. And he still went on to govern Revachol for 25 years. We lost 2 million lives toppling that mode of government, and those grotesque statues there, hundreds of them. But it's still there. What a keen remark, he sputters. Yes, it is, isn't it? It's still there. Do you know why? I don't know. I do. Some advertising cockroaches used their accumulated capital to erect a new, ironic version of it. We tore it down with honest working-class plastic explosives, but there it is again, grinning. He shakes his head in disgust. Art is a bourgeois establishment. It's an affront to humanity. Every gallery should be bulldozed and the artist should be given 30 years of hard labor in Yokokata. I don't agree with that. By the bleep parading in his colorful uniform? You mean Renee? I could probably say that word. I mean, he means a bird, I think. Every morning for 34 years, he grinds his teeth in rage, throwing that ball, one ball against the other. I've always loathed that game. That is not a working-class game. I don't care what they say on Radio Jeune. Royalist ghouls play it like it was life itself. Click-clack. He makes the sound of balls connecting across the water every day. And that uniform, like a parrot's plumage. I won't even mention that he's a traitor to his race. A Patank maniac race traitor. Just nod, I guess. I remember him. He points to his black eye. I remember him from La Noce. Not him personally. His make and model. There were tens of thousands of them. I thought we took them all out before the liberals came to their rescue. We missed one. With a shaky finger, he points to the city, toward the crater near the plaza where a lonely pine tree stands. That one. Fat and plump, like a pheasant, just begging to be popped off. A grin stretches across his face and he whispers, "Please, Mr. Dross, shoot me." "You'd like to kill him?" The smile lingers. "Not yet. I'd like to look at him strut around. Place the crosshair on his medals, right on his face, and just fiddle the trigger. Think about it. Let the bonbon melt in my mouth." "There isn't always dead? Save the treat for later," the lieutenant asks for cheerfully. He is a juicy bonbon, that one. A real treat for the black day, the blackest. When I put that gun in my own mouth, I think, me? No, don't waste it. Put this lead in that Rene for the boys he killed. And then I look at him throw those balls, and I suddenly feel... He lets out a wistful sigh. Better. I even hid one bullet, so I'd always have one. For him. The lines on his face straighten as he looks inland. Haven't seen him around lately, strutting around. Must be down with arthritis. I hope it hurts like hell. I hope he sweats blood. Rene is dead. He died of old age a couple of days ago. No. Yes. The old communist looks at you, his blackberry eyes shaking in disbelief. I waited too long. I waited too long, and now he's dead. I'm sorry, Mr. Dross, the lieutenant says softly. I understand you knew him for a long time. They're all dead now. He just shakes his head. Screw it. Logic says if he really wanted to kill him so bad, he would have done it. There must have been 1,000 black days on those islands, his health ailing. They cared about him. No, you had 1,000 chances to kill him. And I blew them all. What does it matter now? He's gone. Ancient dust. All right, sure, I'll ask that. You cared about him? A little flash of anger. All human beings care about each other. I cared for seeing head explode. And now? Goddamn this world. I'm not sorry. Are you okay, Mr. Dross, to go on? You think I haven't seen people die? It's all I've seen them do. All the other plans we had, to love, to colonize the Pale, it's all screwed. Volition says he's not okay. This is just another black day, and a row of black days. Something strange is keeping him together, making him endure. You mentioned disco whores? I don't even care about those whores anymore. He stares despondently into the reeds. Get it over with. Take me in. You mentioned the Union is a social democratic, and Mr. Clare a farce of the social democrat. I don't want to talk about goddamn social democrats. Traitors is all they are. Brain dead. He waves his arm, agitated and despondent at the same time. Empathy says Rene still presses on in his mind. Huh. Well, he might have said more about this stuff if we hadn't brought up Rene, possibly, but... It's not that I want this background stuff that much. I'm glad we talked about this. Now... Glad we talked about what? Another erratic gesture. He's trembling. Still low. Assess his body language. We can... Put this up, I think. Composure 4? Value, of course. For a 60-year-old man with stomach trouble who spent his entire life alone on an uninhabited island, he seems surprisingly fit. That's it? He's prone to erratic hand gestures and clearly malnourished. You can see no more by looking at his slouched frame. The moment passes by and you say, stay put. That's what I say. I say stay put. Composure, right? Ah, I can't level it up. This is motorics, though. This gives me +1 motorics. I'm just doing drugs in front of the guy. Damage morale. Okay, we have a lot left. Oh, it's still locked. Oh, composure, right? Wait. Oh, I can that's right. I forgot about that. I can level up composure. Still 4 more skill points. Okay, we got even now. This is a white shack. Yep. Oh, wait. Maybe I have to go back out and then in. Wait a second. What's this? Map? We can retry? Smoker on the balcony. Too late for him. I don't know if we can get back to the mainland after this. The deserter. Here we go. Alright, try again. Assess his body language. Success. What strikes you about this gaunt man is not the stomach pain or the cough or the malnutrition. It's precisely what you could not see before. For a man who's spent 44 years hidden in the urban wild, he is surprisingly okay. Indeed, he speaks fluidly. His movements are rapid, if erratic. His voice, despite the cough, is there. It is capable of expressing complicated ideas. Above all, he seems animated. Animated by what? It's a mystery. This animation comes at a cost, too. Erratic hand gestures, thought processes cut off like threads, as he just stares at the logs or the reeds. He also suffers mood swings, bubbling to the surface, unconstrained by his nervous system. Dementia? You've seen demented people before. This feels similar, yet different. When his thoughts move, they are lucid, keen even, not senile. Mr. Draws, are you okay? How is your memory? He waves his hand, chasing something that's not there. No, I'm not okay. I crap blood and I'm surrounded by insane people. Composure says, there it is again. Erratic hand motions, bouts of rage, and the stomach thing too, of course. We talked to him about anything?
Yes.
Alright, no. So I'm gonna go arrest him now. Yosef Lilianovich Dross, you're under arrest for the murder of Ellis Courtenay. What? The old man's eyes fill with sudden, unexpected terror at the words. But you said I wouldn't be taken to the... Empathy says this terror is the sum of all the uncontrollable movements and mood swings he's been exhibiting. Kim says, your wayfarer rights have been suspended. Information provided to the officers on the scene will be used against you by the prosecution. You'll be given legal counsel within 1 week and must face court in 44 days. Do you understand? Do you understand? But... Do you understand, sir? No. I don't want to. I have to stay here. He looks at the reeds, eyes submerged in growing terror. Perception says he's sweating. Beads are forming on his forehead. Your confirmation is not required, sir. The lieutenant turns to you. Now on to the boat. First say, does it have room for three? Not really. Kim shakes his head. We could escort him to the pier, then either one of us could take him inland while the other stays here, but... Logic says, but then who watches him? While you're coming back here. Who watches him there while I come back for you? You come back for me? How about I go and send a boat back for you? What is this farce? He looks around with strange desperation. This is a farce. I can't... Logic says, Lillian, you could ask her, maybe. Maybe I could just ask that netpicker to watch him? This is no harmless old man. Lieutenant shakes his head. Yeah, I agree. This world. He stares at something. Who knows what? In the dust. This world. What is this? Perception hearing says, no, listen. Listen now. Okay, wait. Fail. You thought you heard something, but it's just the reeds. Maybe we could all fit in there, the lieutenant says. We could all fit in a little boat? I wonder what I could have heard. Actually, no. He scratches his head. This head? Okay, you could come back for me once you've taken him to the precinct. Or I could come back for you once I've taken him to the precinct. Yeah. I want to do it myself. Okay, the lieutenant nods. How about I take him to the precinct and you wait on the island? That's not what I said. I'll do it. Let's not get into this. This world, the old man repeats. What are you talking about? Is this... His voice drowns out in a sudden gush of wind. Us. Visual calculus says, the wind is cold from the east. Shivers says, your skin is crawling suddenly. What's coming from the reeds? is that? Oh my god, what? It's the Insulindian phasmid? A delicate tangle of arms and legs unfolds from the reeds, limb by limb, to just stand there, moving its scythe-like arms in ghostly silence.